does that mean? I mean, is there a procedure or, what are options?
Grant, first you need to realize this is a fairly common problem for men. There are thousands of couples who are unable to have children. You do have options. All of them are tens.
Serving God, We go through a lot of things. Life happens, doesn't it? Through the movie Facing the Giants, you've got a coach who's on a losing, he's coaching a losing team. His truck keeps breaking down. He and his wife are unable to have a child. There are people who are out to get his job. And everything just seems to be falling apart. And he's going, woe is me, why is this happening to me? And the Lord gets a hold of him. And there comes a point where he just gives it all to God. And he basically says, Lord, while I wait, I'll serve. As we look at the passage of Scripture tonight, the Apostle Paul was someone who himself was in a position where he had to wait. He was in prison. And while he waited on the Lord, he continued to serve God. And he wrote a letter to the church of Philippi, among other letters that he would write. He wrote to a church that was also going to be experiencing difficulty of life, troubles that would come their way. And I truly believe that the Word of God today applies to us more today than any other time in history. For we all go through difficulty. Whether it's an individual or a church, life happens. Unexpected events occur. How we do it says a lot about who we serve. If you'd open your Bibles up, please, to Philippians chapter 1. We'll be reading 19, verses 19 through 26. I'll be reading from the New King James Version, I believe. Is that right?
It is.
All right. Well, I'm about to tell you. You're right.
I hope so.
And in God's Word, the Apostle Paul wrote this. For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayers and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I cannot tell. For I am hard-pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. And being confident of this, I know that I shall remain and continue with you in all, and with you all for your progress and joy of faith, that your rejoicing for me may be more abundant in Jesus Christ by coming to you again. Let's pray, and then I want to share four thoughts this evening while we wait on the Lord what God will do. Let's pray. Dear Father God, we thank you so much, Lord, for your word. We do ask now that you speak to our hearts. You encourage us through the words on the page that we read. But not just any page, not just any words, not just any book, your word, the Bible. God, speak to us now. Help us to apply the principles found within this word to our lives so that we might indeed live a life that glorifies your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we look at this passage of Scripture. The first thought I want to share can be found in verses 19 and 20, and I'll share this again. For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. The first thing I want to share is while we wait on the Lord, this is important to know. We are compelled to boldness. We are compelled to boldness, to be bold in the Lord. Paul, as he wrote a letter from prison, was speaking with confidence, saying that my life will magnify God. I can boldly proclaim Jesus because of the Holy Spirit's prompting. When we struggle, when something tragic happens to us, whether it seems insignificant to others or it's significant to all, I can promise you this. God is with you. God cares. God loves. And He can use this situation in your life to boldly proclaim that He is Lord. How you react to your circumstance speaks volumes to a world around us. Paul spoke with confidence of what God was doing in his life. He was bold in his proclamation. Remember, he was chained up, not free to go where he wanted to go. And yet, as we learned last week, he said this actually was to the furtherance of the gospel, for he was able to proclaim Jesus to the palace guard, to those who were holding him captive. And he praised God for that fact. He boldly spoke about who Jesus was in his life. He encouraged the people around him to embrace the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This morning I had the pleasure, the privilege even, we'll even use the word honor, James, to hear James Rutter share his first sermon. And I've put the little quotation marks there for emphasis. This first sermon, because your life is a sermon, you live every day proclaiming Christ. But James had the opportunity to share his first message from behind something like a pulpit. And he spoke of how he referenced Elijah and Elisha, where Elisha asked for a double portion of blessing, and he wanted to boldly proclaim the gospel. And in part of the aspect of his message that really comes out to me that I want to emphasize is that he spoke of his father, and I think my dad.